Your Excellency, my name is Alice Ukoko. It's such a huge honor to be with you.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am.
Madam First Lady, my colleagues, Honourable Deputy Minister, members of Parliament, to our honoured guest, Madam Alice Ukoko. Let me take this opportunity to welcome you on behalf of the First Lady of the Republic of Sierra Leone, Madam Sia Koroma, to our office. Indeed, Madam Ukoko, we are very much impressed with your work in Africa and especially in the area of trying to empower women and somehow trying to unite the voices of Africa. I think Africa is ripe for that moment. And so I want to take this opportunity, first of all, to congratulate you on the work that you've been doing and that we are very much impressed to have you and honored to have you in our midst. Yes. On that note, I will ask Honorable Marie Jallo to introduce your delegation.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, thank you.
Excellency Mark.
Members of the delegation, members and staff of the Office of the First Lady, it's my pleasure now to introduce the delegation that we have right now. With me here, I have our renowned minority leader in Parliament, a woman herself, and a member of the female caucus, parliamentary caucus in Parliament. She is Honorable Dr. Melanie Lahan. Next, by my side, on my right-hand side, we have Madam Fatou, who is the Chief Executive Officer in the Ministry of Gender, Social Welfare and Children's Affairs. We also have our guest. She is somebody I think who works straightly with the Office of the First Lady. I think she's the only one I think we have here in Sierra Leone, who is a psychosocial therapist. She is Madam Mamoussou Conte-Jones. She's from the USA. She's here with us. And we have the Honorable Salima Touré, who was a member of Parliament, and also my personal assistant in the Ministry of Agriculture and Deputy Minister. And we have we have a journalist from the World New Vision newspaper.
I think it's also appropriate that we also introduce ourselves.
Good. So,
that
you know, so thank you very much.
So we'll start with
And myself?
Oh! No, no, don't worry.
Who are you?
And myself, the Honorable Marie Jallo, the Deputy Minister of Agriculture, Forestry and Security, and a member of the Female Parliamentary Caucus as well.
Good afternoon. My name is Sheikh Nami. I am the accountant of the First Lady's Office.
Bugia Tugangura, program officer, Wish. Which Women Initiative for Safer Health, we advocate on the reduction of maternal mortality.
Commander Peters, the IT, Office of the First Lady.
I'm Moses Beckley, the Programs Officer for Teenage Pregnancy and Early Marriage.
I'm Kobe Kwafu from the SIBC. And it's Jerry Cole also.
I'm Sam Bangura, I'm the Policy Advisor, Office of the First Lady. So what we'll do, we'll hand it over to you because I'm sure you came with a message, and then we'll ask our honored guest to say a word.
I waited for this opportunity. I now have the honor, Your Excellency, ma'am, to introduce our guest of honor, who has been here almost a week. She's going back tomorrow, God willing. She's Alice Ukoko, she has been a woman all over the place in Africa to try to bring women's voices on top internationally, worldwide. She has worked so hard, and we are happy to have her with us in Sierra Leone, and especially to have a first visit to Your Excellency, Madam. So we have in our midst Madam Alice Ukoko. You're welcome. Over to you.
Your Excellency, I want to mention that I'm sure you have noticed that I actually dressed today. I am so honored, and I'm so proud. I'm so proud, I'm so honored to be in your presence, and in the presence of honorable ladies, and all our ladies. I'm sorry, ma'am, that I have not been able to see you. This is because the program for me, if I'm traveling one way in Sierra Leone, I'm not sure where I'm going, so I cannot go around. It's not because I have not cared about Sierra Leone. I have actually been very much in touch and in tune with what has been going on in Sierra Leone. Particularly at the time of the Civil War, that was the time I would have come to Sierra Leone, because I was very concerned about the war that was going on. And it was a war that the women and children knew nothing about. But yet, it was a battleground, a ground where war was fought, and the women and the children were the maximum victims of that war. I struggled very hard, I campaigned, I'm a world-class campaigner for you, because I stand on your shoulders. I remember at the time, I was very concerned, and I wrote to Robin Cook, the British, I'm based in the UK, I told him that I'm very concerned, and women of Africa are extremely concerned that we continue to be the grass that where giants are fighting. And the fight goes on, not in our benefit, but over our shoulders, somebody else is benefiting, and that I was not. Women are not war makers. We are peacemakers, and we are the stabilizing force of Africa. We are the stabilizing force of the world, but in particular of Africa now. Because you know that Africa, life began in Africa, civilization began in Africa. But somewhere along the line, man, things went wrong. And as I say sometimes, that when the traders came, both the commercial and the slave traders came into Africa, as it is, the practice in Africa, the culture of Africans, the man is the head of the home. So of course, and we love strangers. So we call the chiefs and we call our head that, look, we have visitors. Let's welcome our visitors. And as it is always the man, please correct me if I'm wrong, but I know I'm right. It's the man that takes the visitors in and then tell the people, entertain the people, where Mother Africa, Mama goes to the back and say, right, Baba, take care of these people. We are going to take care of the entertainment, the food. And usually all the time, as I was actually reminded in Cote d'Ivoire, that in fact the African men have always respected the African women. And I think I will agree to that. Yes, it's very true that our men have continued to love us, our men have continued to honor us, but yet there has been a problem. And that problem started when the visitors came in. The visitors came, the women were outside cooking. They were making sure that Papa is well catered for and raised, the profile is raised. But then the visitors refused to leave. Because if the visitor had left, the culture is, once the visitors go, then Papa report back to Mama, and then Mama say, yes, all right, we've heard what happened. But the issue is, we have had the misfortune, if you like, of the wealth. We have a lot of wealth in Africa. Africa is the richest continent in the whole world. And as we say that Africa will actually rule the world, and we believe that we talk about poverty, Africa, we solve the problem of food shortage in the whole world, not just in Africa. We have enough, but the problem we have had is that because our visitors did not leave, we found ourselves in a vacuum where we are no longer able, Papa is not able to communicate with us, we are not able to interrupt Papa, what Papa was doing here, to say, because the stranger is still here. So now we realize that globalization carried us, but as it carried us away, it left us behind. Because the visitors that came misconstrued Mama in the kitchen trying to make this happen, to make him comfortable. He thought that Papa was abusing Mama, and we said, no, you have gotten the wrong end of the stick. And we have not. It's taken us this long to be able to tell the world
that in actual fact, African women are not the victims. African women, in fact, are the backbone of Africa. Mm-hmm. And if you go into the rural area today, you will find that our women are there toiling. They are working so hard. Mm-hmm. They are the ones that they are concerned whether the child has food before he goes to school. Mm-hmm. She's even concerned that, look, I don't want anything for myself. I just want my child to do well, so that in the end, I will have a good old age. That is the kind of agenda that the African woman has. And that is the agenda that the African woman have continued to pursue. But unfortunately, we find ourselves in a place where globalization has now lifted us into a place. Everybody come around and want to educate the girl child. Mm-hmm. And I said, I'm sorry, what about me? Am I an illiterate? Mm-hmm. And what about Her Excellency? Is she an illiterate? So in actual fact, because of the misconstruction of who we are, our tradition and our culture, people think that we are not educated, we don't educate our children, but that's not true at all. They say that we don't understand how to even breastfeed our children, and sometimes I feel very, very, very upset, and in fact, I feel that Mama Africa is being insulted by the global world that we find ourselves. So for that, we realize that because for things to change, the mother needs to take her place. Because we have now seen a situation where the father is here, the mother is out there, because the mother is still out in cold. So the pain we feel, the mother is the one being separated from the system, and that's why we now say, and I say it all the time, that because papa has not had the privilege of conferring with mama to say, how do we deal with this? The man has been carried into somewhere, mm-hmm. into a place even himself does not understand. Mm-hmm. So we now see globalization that has continuously enslaved Africa. Mm-hmm. They tell us that they want to do convention here and convention there. And it is those conventions that are meant to take care of us. But we said, no, the time has come. Mm-hmm. The time has come and Africa has come of age. And this time now means that mama will not push herself into this stage and say, visitor, it's time for you to either listen or you go. Because we cannot continue to live a life that is kind of suspended. Because our life is suspended. If you have a visitor in the house, you are not yourself. You try to make things and give a good impression to the visitor. So you are not actually living your life. But it's time now that Africa should recover from the dark ages that we've suffered. The civil wars that we have nothing to do about. The poverty that they say we have. I go to the market all the time. I've actually been to the market here. And if you're passing, you're driving, you see people selling food. That is not is food. That is not empty shelves. Those are food. But yet we have been made to believe that there's poverty in Africa. There is no poverty in Africa. Because Africa is feeding the world. Africa is capable of feeding the world. So the agenda that we have is to say the time is now. Mother must take her place. Mm-hmm. Gender must balance. Mm-hmm. Because if gender does not balance, mm-hmm. then obviously our world will slip. Mm-hmm. Because the world as God created it, created the man and created the woman. Everyone has his place in it. And it's not, we've had whatever the putting down that we've had has not been because of our culture. It has been because the stranger came and misinterpreted what they saw. So we have not been able to give the chance to our culture and our traditions and our political and our economic system to grow, because we've always had people watching over us. And we've said we can no longer be watched over as if we're people, animals in the zoo. We're not in the zoo. We are Africans. So we're now working to facilitate the African Women Congress. And that Congress is the first ever in the whole world. Mm-hmm. We have seen decades of African women. All of it is talk. 1995, there was a Beijing platform for women. Mm-hmm. What happened? Nothing. So our women, especially in the grassroots, women continue to watch. They don't understand what's going on. They continue to suffer. The suffering is going on. And one of the things, your Excellency, that bothers me is the sexual abuse that the African women have had to put up with for a very long time now, and mm-hmm. it's not getting better. Mm-hmm. And I say that because of sexual abuse, mm-hmm. Africa would take a longer time to heal, because by tradition, mm-hmm. an African son does not rape his mother. And every African mother, woman, mm-hmm. represents the African mother. So if you have African men raping the African woman, mm-hmm. that means that the African son is raping his mother, and it is a taboo. Mm-hmm. So these are things that we need to correct. And it will not be, it's not going to take the UN to correct it. It is not going to take the United Kingdom to correct it, because we saw how they operate. The NATO, what do NATO do? They come in and they do a lot of havoc in our continent. We saw what happened in Libya when Gaddafi was killed. I'm not saying that Gaddafi ought to have been there for a lifetime. He's supposed to have gone. But yet, Libya and Africa, we are people that have sovereignty in our own right. So no other power has a right to come in and decide for us how we do, or to kill our son and slaughter him in our own soil. So we have that. I get emotional when I think about it, because it builds on the catalogue of the insult and the violations that we have had to endure. So what we are saying is, this time has come that we need, African women need to come around the table. They can speak for themselves, they can talk about the challenges they have, and they can also come up with solutions that are meant to lift us from where we are, because we must come out of where we are. And at that Congress, we hope that we also have a leaflet here where we are saying that one of the things that will come out of that, there are four main things that will come out of the Congress, apart from the fact that it brings representatives, and also including grassroots. We want the grassroots to go in with, I'm so glad, Your Excellency, that Honorable Marie and my Honorable here are coordinating Sierra Leone. And we want the grassroots, the women themselves inside the villages, to elect their leaders, and their leaders should be at the place. Because what they experience, nobody else can say it for them. Only them can say it. And the world needs to hear what they have to say. It's not about us fighting, it's about the people recognizing that in actual fact, we rule the world. African women rule the world, but they have not given us the chance to rule the world. So we are saying to them, we're going to come round and we're going to begin to have our voices heard. We are part of Africa. We want to have the opportunity to begin to advise our husbands and our governments as to what should happen. Not the kind of situation we have now, when in the EU, they say they are having partnership with AU, and the partnership is purely, if we give you money, then you will keep your boundaries so that your ants don't crawl across. That, we say, you are here doing all sorts of things, you are taking our wealth and going away, nobody's asking you, but you think that when you have impoverished our land, then our children that are born with silver spoons in their mouth, are now going to be sitting down, and you will come, and you be the NGO that is going to support them. The answer is no. So, Your Excellency, at the Congress, we are going to create a body, and that is the African Women Commission. Mm-hmm. It will not be, the Congress is not going to be like all Congresses. Mm-hmm. On the 8th of March, mm-hmm. It's International Women's Day. Mm-hmm. Then you celebrate and everybody go home. Then they pat their backs and say, yeah, we're doing very well. Because as long as we continue to keep these women celebrating, then all is fine. No, all is not fine. The time has come. We are Africans. This is our continent. We are stakeholders in this continent. And in fact, since they come here, we are also stakeholders in the new found globalized village. So we are going to create the African Women Commission, and this commission is going to be a standing commission. It's not going to be something that you're going to do, then tomorrow you go. The women representatives are then going to have all over across the continent. We then have, of course, diaspora as well, because all of it is to do with Africans' descendants that have not are yet to return home from captivity, the old slave trade. So obviously, we have representatives in the commission. And the commission, Your Excellency, is to have its headquarters in New York. I've never been to New York, but I think it's because the UN is in New York. So if the world is global, then our grassroots women here, we also have their representatives in New York. So once we have our representatives in New York, that they are representing our women here, then their voices will be heard over there, and whatever is happening over there, somebody will be telling them here that, sorry, this is what we agreed. The day you misbehave, you come out, because the women will have the power to say, sorry, we've had enough. You have not reported back to us. So we are talking about accountability. We are talking about the voices that we say, we've had enough of sexual abuse. We've had enough of us living a miserable life without counseling. Nobody cares. Most Africans are traumatized. And I'm not just talking about the women. most Africans, men and women, are traumatized because they have put us in a pigeonhole. We are Africans. You cannot cage us, but they have caged us for so long. They've told us how to live our lives. They've told us how to abandon our families. They've told us how to give no job to our people. In other words, they have underdeveloped Africa. And the time is now, Your Excellency, that this is what is going to happen. And we are here today to raise the voice, and also most especially, Your Excellency. You know that our voice is very weak. Yes. In the African government, nobody hears us. So we are saying that we want you to please use your good office to reach out to other first ladies. Tell them that the time has come. We cannot mess about anymore. That if we cannot have this change in our lifetime, then we are condemning our children to a life of even deeper, deeper oppression. Yes. And the time is past. We have come of age, Your Excellency. And I think I'll stop here. I'm sorry I've taken so much of the time, but I'm so excited and I have so much to say. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much for that.
Thank you so much.
So thrilled.
So cordial. That was well said, and thank you for reminding us about our history and where we've come from and where we are. And it really reminds me of what Chinua Achebe said, that they put a knife on the things that held us together and we are falling apart. And indeed, basically, I like what you said. And so you came with a delegation, and I'm going to open up the floor to any member of the delegation that wants to say anything before the First Lady.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Yes.
We are indeed happy to have Alice with us. She's a great woman, and though in Nigeria, she has lived most of her time in the UK, and she is very much buffet with international political practices, and as she's speaking, you can see the passion that eludes her. We have just celebrated the 50th anniversary of the African Union, of the African OAU, and we are now preparing for the next 50 years, and we are talking about African Renaissance, African Renaissance, Africa for Africa. Africa, one voice. I think that is the message now, the next 50 years we are working towards. The past 50 years, I'm sure we have put together the institutions, even though they are yet to be very much alive and running and kicking, you know. But I'm sure we have achieved a lot, because we've raised the African consciousness. We've raised, you know, what we are now talking about, shared vision. You know, shared vision. But what can we as Africa do for Africa, within Africa, you know, to take our own destiny in our own hands, given the many resources we have. We have the human resources. We have the natural resources. So we already have all the building blocks. So as we move towards the next 50 years, we are working towards strengthening our institutions, like the African courts, you know, that has its headquarters in Gambia. Why should our African people, you know, be trying the Hague? You know, why should they? Because we have not given the alternative, you know, a strong and vibrant and working African Court of Justice. We have the African Union Commission, which is an administrative organ, you know, of the African Union. We are happy that it's being run by a woman. And our vision, and because we've interacted with her many times, she has a vision and all those things. So what a coincidence that as we move, you know, from 50 years, and I'm moving to the next 50 years, we have a woman who also has the strength, the intellectual capacity, you know, to lead that part. But as we are saying, this time, we don't want to leave the women behind. We don't want to leave women behind. That is why, you know, even as this decade has been dedicated to the African Women's Decade, you know. Also, the African Women's Fund, you know, is being developed, you know, so that it can also help. But we need an institutional structure. So having an African Women's Commission, you know, I think will be the structure that will ensure that, you know, it encapsulates, you know, this vision for the next 50 years. That structure will provide the enabling environment, provide the policy environment, you know, for us to move along with the general policies of the African Union for the next 50 years. So this Congress is going to be held in Cote d'Ivoire. They have graciously accepted to hold it. And maybe why Cote d'Ivoire? Because we may think it's a French-speaking country. But for us women, language should no longer be a barrier for us. Our problems, apart from language, remain the same. So it speaks, our problems without the language speak volumes. You go in anywhere, whether it's a French-speaking country, Portuguese country, observe the day of the woman. As she wakes up in the morning and until she goes back to bed, you know. You don't need a language, you know, to understand, to tell you what that woman is, who that woman is, what is she suffering, what her needs are suffering. So Cote d'Ivoire, we have chosen, especially we have just come again, day two from this conflict, you know. And we know that the women were there, you know, not being creators of the problem, but they have, you know, embroiled and you know, bore it all, you know. So therefore, again, there is a visibility, maybe, with that meeting being held, you know, we want to send a message to the world that, yes, Ivory Coast, things are working, things are settling down, you know, but also we have women there, you know, and they are willing and ready to embrace their other sisters. That is why it's happening. And our first lady, as our mother, our sister, you know, and apart from, quite apart from, because you have chosen yourself a niche, you know, which is the bedrock, you know, for all the women's empowerment you're talking about. If we don't reduce the teenage pregnancy, if we don't ensure that women or girls go to school, but they don't only go to school, they stay there, they move on to university, and come out, you know, like educated mothers that we're looking at. Because once we are educated, you know, there's so much that the woman can do. So that empowerment, you know, you have started where the building blocks starts to crumble. Because once they get out of school early, you know, the chances for them to go back to school is easier. So we are asking you, we are begging you to lead us, you know, to after she leaves, to help us generate more dialogue and so forth, and see how Sierra Leone women we are going to position ourselves. We will come next year, you know, for this African Women's Congress, you know, and we'll make sure that we play our role, because we've done so much. Coming after the war, we've done so much. Today, yesterday, today and tomorrow, you know, we are also doing our seed report, you know, and that report is rich, because it's telling us, you know, what we have done and what we need to do. So these are all the things that maybe between now and next year as well. Work towards the Congress, and we want you to provide us both the political, the intellectual, the social leadership, you know, so that you will lead us to that conference and position Sierra Leone, you know, in a way that we will not only be visible, but we will bring along the voices of women in the rural areas and all types of women that characterizes Sierra Leone.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I've just stealing my voice to what my great ladies have said. Your Excellency, Ma, we choose it as an opportunity to come to you. We know what you have done already. Not because you are seated here, but we are proud of you, very much proud in moving the women's agenda in Sierra Leone. You have done a lot, the women and the children. You've done a lot. Has been the first lady ever that have gone so far in terms of looking at gender issues in Italy and health issues in terms of women and children. God will bless you. But we also want to, we cannot do it by ourselves as well. We need you to lead us through in this whole program that we are starting. We are starting as women, ordinary women, but we want to get there. And when we get there, then we know the ordinary women have a voice to say in this whole thing. But as a country, Madam Alice, we have done a lot. Already, this is the first time in the history of this nation for us to have Pillar 8 working on gender issues, women's everywhere. And in my ministry, you know already, I'm biased. So I already have developed a gender mainstream strategy for 5 years in the history of the country, looking at our constituency, which is the women. And we must bring them on top. So, Madam, we really need your support, and I will always be following up with you, ma'am, to help us get where we want to go by next year. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you very much, ma'am.
Thank you very much. Yes.
And welcome you once more. I join my sister. Welcome, Mr. Leone. I think your visit is very much timely. It reminds me of the time when Madame Lisbeth Wanga was the chairman, a very eminent and UNDP country representative, who thought that Sierra Leone could have a church together. So she organized a meeting for the whole meeting, for something like a consultative meeting, wherein the voices of women, you and women, you know, will be had for them to come out to between policies, one on gender and mainstream and the one on the advancement of women. And I'm just from the meeting that I led in the CCO, they are not being discussing way forward. And I'm sure she did believe many times, but I think Sierra Leone is not too far behind. Mm-hmm. Only I tell conferences, Sierra Leone is always outstanding because we do our work. Mm-hmm. We work as a team, irrespective of political as well as anything. We don't care. When we go to the field, we are working as a team. Mm-hmm. So on account of that, I'm so happy. And I do join my colleagues in welcoming you. And at the same time, we are praying towards for a success in your venture, so that all of us as speak as one African.
Thank you.
Hi, children, an African woman. She has done it all. So it's my pleasure to present it. And this is the brochure, small write up on the conference.
Thank you very much, madam.
Thank you. Thank you.
I think we have to leave the floor to our first lady, who is a champion in the online. She has working together. We have a good working relationship. She keeps saying, I'm going to make you think like a woman. but it's been good working with her. And she's a leader. And I think you have come to the right person. She knows how to bring people together. And status is non-existent. She deals with the low, she deals with the high and mighty, and she deals with people like us. Not for you guys. But in all seriousness, I think she carries a passion for her work. And somehow we are attracted to the passion. And that's why we are here. You know, she's making history in Sierra Leone because as far as I know, this is the first office of the First Lady in Sierra Leone that is being institutionalized. And therefore, she is a history maker as well. Now, I won't say much, but I'll just hand over to the First Lady of Sierra Leone, Mrs. Nyama.
Yes, our Honorable Minority Leader in Parliament, Dr. Bernadette Lahai, our Members of Parliament, our Ministry Official, Sifatu, Members of the Office of the First Lady, Press, all other protocols observed, let me on behalf of my people, in particular the women and children of Sierra Leone, welcome you to our shores. You are a great woman. You are a wonderful woman. Just by talking to you, I can see how much strength and passion you have for women of Africa to make a difference. If you look on the wall, I'm a member of OFLAP and I'm a member of the African First Ladies Peace Initiative. And there in Nigeria, if I can remember, I made a passionate speech, I'm not sure if it was Nigeria, where I said, my speechwriter is here, we said together, this is time for us as women of Africa to reposition ourselves for the great transformation. The men, it was a mixed conference. They said to me, some of them said, you are sounding like a president, Madam First Lady. This is how we want African women to think. And it's a good thing for African men, even African leaders, to think that way. Women, we all know we are the pivot of society. We are very important. And we all know where the problem is. It's at the rural level. So we must show concern. We must have passionate for the less fortunate. We must bring our women folk along. We should rise up from our slumber and sleep. Let us rise up from our comfort zones and move Africa forward. You are right. I mean, this is where these men tell me that I must be a conscious thinker, speak like a conscious woman. Because we have our raw materials, but we have not managed our resources well in the past. Almost every African country, we all know that we have mismanaged our resources. And I'm glad you have taken us aback. You've taken us to the starting point of the problems. You are taking us to pre-independence now. So Africa has suffered because we have not managed our resources well. So now let us manage what is left. Let us plan ahead for the next 50 years, as Dr. Bernadette Lahai says. Our problems are synonymous. You have the same problem in Nigeria, in America, all over the world. The African woman is a woman. We have been marginalized. We have suffered. We have been disgraced. We have been discriminated against. So we must not be resilient. We should fight to make the situation different. I'm in support of your work, and I'm going to assure you that as First Lady, I'll support you.
Thank you.
Okay. I'll support you. You will have my blessings. I'm going to encourage my women folk in Sierra Leone to support you.
Thank you.
I'm leaving them to start the organization. They should start identifying women from the grassroots level, at all level, middle level. This is the only way society can have a change.
Mm-hmm.
I've done a lot of work on women's empowerment. I'm sure you've done an internet check on me.
Mm-hmm.
But the one I enjoy most, apart from my health initiative, is attitudes and behavior. Taking flaxes, I call it First Ladies Attitudinal Change in Schools.
Yes.
When you take attitudinal change to school children, it's amazing what we come out with at the end of these interactive sessions. So as women, we should not be resilient. We should work hard to make that change. I'm glad the office is going to be in New York, so our grassroots people must see the other side of the spectrum and see. But the world is in Africa.
Yes.
So now we have to reverse migration.
Yes.
I don't know if you sociologists call it de-migration. Let us reverse all the economic potentials at the same time and bring our wealth that has gone back to Africa.
Yes.
So yes. Count on my support.
Thank you.
And I'll be there for you.
Thank you.
Language is no barrier.
No.
I do French lessons as well, simply because I want to communicate fluently with my friends in the sub-region. So I'm making an effort to learn French. It's not easy, but at least I can communicate, basically. So once again, let me thank all of you for being here. Let me thank you for your good work. I'm sure you've enjoyed your stay in Sierra Leone.
I have. Thanks
so,
to my sisters.
When you leave, take back pleasant memories of us.
Thank
and
you.
I like to see you in a traditional Creole attire print. Because this is unique to Sierra Leone.
Yes. Yes.
And it is the only country you find wearing this. You look beautiful
yes.
in this. But before you leave, I'll give you my traditional wear as well, the country cloth.
Wow.
This
wow.
is the Australian. As a reminder
wonderful.
That you have women in Sierra Leone who are in
wow.
support of your work
wow.
and who are there for you.
That is something.
Okay, well,
wow.
she has just arrived.
Perfect
so,
time.
Wow.
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 Yeah.
Wow.
Wow.
This is huge.
This is huge.
This is huge. Wow!
Oh.
Wow!
Wow!
You can just dress around and
do it.
Just do like this.
Use it as a bed cover, sofa cover, partner, whatever you want.
Wonderful.
This is
huge.
Holding this.
It's
falling.
My earrings.
Oh my God. It's really lovely.
It's
beautiful.
Nice.
So you have to be checking on that.
That's good.
Thank you.
please, no, no, you are standing. Yes, standing. Go on, next, you're standing at the wrong.
Please,
We'll engender you, don't worry.
The truck is not, it's just to transport the vegetables.
No, this is.
And we have already provided a cold room. So the freezer just.
Yes, they have the cold room, but they need this coal for transport the vegetables.
You don't do more than one, and that will be
last. Believe me, we are so not.
I'm not talking to a woman. Anytime.
They are ready for a good video. Oh, they send the ID for his TV. So to serve the whole of Kabbalah access.
Ah, thank you.
Yes, then will they bring the vegetables direct to
food. It's not good news. Value chain of food. From production
precisely,
to
yeah, because the cold store is there.
So let me link them to the market. Don't try. I don't go to add that.
No, that's
peace and unity. Yes. Let us now. Let us do it. Let us do it.
Let's hold it.
Let's hold it.
Yes.
Yes. We make peace.
No, you
come
here.
Come here.
Thank you.
My name is not.